Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. On behalf of Aid Environment, Profundo, and Climate Advisors, the consortium behind Chain Reaction Research, it is my pleasure to welcome you to this webinar on the reputational risks and potential value losses that fast-moving consumer goods companies face due to deforestation. My name is Ben Simons, and I'm the Director of Communications at Climate Advisors. Today, we are joined by Gerard Reich, Equity Analyst with Profundo, and Matt Piotrowski, a Senior Analyst at Climate Advisors. Gerard will deliver the main presentation, and Matt will then moderate the question and answer session. Before we get started, a few quick pieces of information. First, please be advised that we are recording this webinar, and we will be sharing it on the Chain Reaction Research website and YouTube channel. For those who cannot join us today, and also for those who want to revisit some of the key elements of our discussion. Second, following the presentations, we will have a question and answer session. To send us a question or to communicate with us during the webinar, please use the chat panel at the bottom of your screen. We will do our best to get to all questions while keeping within the allotted time. So with those bits of housekeeping out of the way, it is now my pleasure to turn it over to Gerard. Gerard, you have the floor.
Yes, good morning, and for others, good afternoon. Thank you for listening in and participating in this webinar on the value of reputation risk, and which we here apply to deforestation and fast-moving consumer good companies, the FMCGs, we call them. And maybe we can turn to the next slide, where we put the key question on this of this webinar and the agenda. And with the 2020 approaching, it's a very fundamental question: why are fast-moving consumer goods in companies in danger of deforestation-driven reputation risks? And what we are in particular looking for is what are the potential value losses for these companies. Well, in order to kick off the analysis shortly through the agenda, short introduction of Chain Reaction Research, the existing financial risk methodologies that we use, and additionally to that, the new reputation risk methodology. We are looking to some definition and challenges. The value of the reputation risk, we look to the literature on what has been published up to now. We have some case studies on which we did some calculations. We look to the trend of increasing risk of reputation value loss. That's in fact already a conclusion that which I mentioned here. Lagging action on deforestation by fast-moving consumer goods, and we wrap up with the conclusion. If you look to the next slide, Chain Reaction Research, it's a coalition of three partners. It's Aid Environment with offices in Bogor, Indonesia, Amsterdam, Netherlands, and in Uganda. Climate Advisor is based in the United States, and Profundo is based in Amsterdam. Well, this coalition, and that is something we can see on the next slide, focus and output. Of course, we are analyzing the deforestation risks for financiers. That's the key focus of Chain Reaction Research. Take into account deforestation in tropical areas lead to climate change, biodiversity loss, and social conflicts. 13% of the global CO2 emissions is generated by deforestation. And of this, 71% of the deforestation is driven by agricultural commodities, of which cattle, soy, palm oil, and timber contribute an large majority. Output from Chain Reaction Research, next to the sustainability analysis, supply chain analysis, policy analysis, and the reports, of course, on companies and themes, including the equity analysis. We do a lot of engagement with companies, investors, and also central banks about the outcomes of our reports and the outreach. That is through the website, and on the next slide, you can see, you probably know this website where you can find the reports, the events, the contact details, and of course the weekly change that we publish. Well, if we turn to the next slide about the buildup of our analyze the financial risk. Well, as an input, we use the sustainability analysis, which is produced by Aid Environment. We look to the key financials of the companies, the list of investors, as well as in equity as in debt, and the list of banks. And then we look to the different operational to the different risks, like market access risk, regulatory risk, financing risk, stranded asset risk, and also reputational risk. Gets from here on more hands and feet. We look to the impact on the sales revenues, the earnings per share numbers, the discounted cash flow, the DCF, and the net debt EBITDA ratio, which is a crucial one. And well, in fact, the result is that we have engagement with shareholders, with companies, and also that the result might be from this analysis that there will be that we analyze an valuation impact, and that is something that can really happen afterwards. If we look to the next slide about the let's say the existing financial risk methodologies, and we have applied them a lot to upstream, the producers, the plantations, and the soy producers, and to the midstream, the traders like Bunge and ADM. Stranded assets is something which is really mostly applicable to the producers, the plantations, and well, we calculate here the anticipated cash flows which will not materialize on certain pieces of land that they have under control, like forests, and also to the restoration cost that might occur. That's mainly in palm oil. In soy, it's more about land and silos, infrastructure. And in beef, it is more about slaughterhouses, sometimes land, and where from which we calculate the investments. More important, in fact, is what we have seen in the past is the market access risk, and that is the risk that plantations, producers, soy producers have the risk of losing access to the market. Because customers have certain deforestation policies, and if a producer, an upstream company, does not comply to that, then there is a risk of market access risk, and we calculate that as a percentage of equity value. And in fact, we calculate here a discounted cash flow number. And we show that often through as a percentage of the equity value or as a percentage of the enterprise value, which includes the equity value and the value of the net debt of a company. A third risk is the financing risk, which we always calculate, and that's the potential impact on the cost of capital. A loss in EBITDA might really have a big impact on the net debt EBITDA ratio, which might lead to higher interest costs. And what we have seen in the past is that banks increasingly are introducing ESG related cost of debt, and that's a very interesting development. And we have already seen that there can be differences of around 50 basis points in the weighted cost of capital for companies, and this might impact the enterprise value and the equity value substantially. This might translate, if debt is 50% of the total value of a company, this might translate into 10 to 20% impact on the equity value, and that is quite a large number. However, and that's where we turn to the next slide. For the fast-moving consumer goods, it is worth to take another stance. The fast-moving consumer goods, let's say the downstream sector. And the context here is that it is really worth to explore the value impact of reputation risk that fast-moving consumer goods might experience if they are not able to meet the 2020 zero deforestation deadlines. The companies have been signatories of several statements like the Zero Net Deforestation Resolution by the Consumer Goods Forum and or the New York Declaration on Forests. And they all support 2020 targets to end deforestation in supply chains. So with this 2020 deadline moving in, we've already seen many NGOs campaigning against several fast-moving consumer good companies. And the examples can be found in our report. Nestle, Mondelez, restaurant brands, and PepsiCo have been subject here. And also, there have been many benchmark studies, so peer pressure reports, which have been issued, comparing the different companies, how their policies are, or how they are executing their policies. Fast-moving consumer goods, and an additional point in the context is very important. Fast-moving consumer goods, they are not really hit by stranded assets in deforestation. They don't own plantations. They don't own land where soy is produced. The revenue at risk is, let's say, fairly limited. If they have some raw materials from deforested land in their supply chain for a certain product, they might lose some sales in that product. But the companies overall are very diversified, so that other products are not hurt. So the pressure on the financials is then relatively small for fast-moving consumer good companies. And also looking to the cost of debt, these companies have often, not always, but often they have a relatively strong balance sheet. And well, when they lose some EBITDA, then the impact on the cost of capital is not severe. So they don't see such a big impact as I mentioned before. Therefore, the traditional tools for the value at risk are less applicable for the fast moving consumer good companies. Well, the consequence of the 2020 thing is that this deadline may lead to a growing awareness among stakeholders, and more NGO campaigns will be there, and more action by ESG investors, and also regulation might follow. Well, take a look at what is happening in the European Union and deforestation. Well, this could really affect the reputation of individual fast-moving consumer good companies, and then this reputation risk thing is already gaining a lot of attention as a consequence of the increasing transparency of supply chains, the tighter regulation, and also the increasing globalization of markets. So taking this everything together, it's really worthwhile to have an analysis on the value of reputation risk. And that's important for investors, because investors can then know, well, what the loss can be in their portfolios. And for companies, it might be very important to know what how much value loss they can prevent. If you look to the definition and challenges, reputation, of course, our goal is to add a value to the reputation risk. And we have looked to several methodologies, and there are a lot of research done on qualitative methodologies. And that is, these methodologies, they assign a numeric score to the reputation of an organization or a part of the organization. They use surveys for this, and they use check marks for this. Well, this is something that is not working to calculate a value of reputation risk. So what we really need is quantitative methodologies, and often they have a straightforward methodology which does not always really work. We have seen differences between what many research is looking at is difference between a company's market value and the market capitalization and the book value. That difference should be something of goodwill and of reputation. The problem is that book value is only given once per year, so you cannot see something happening in between. And as a refinement here, the brand value is sometimes the earnings capacity of a brand. Well, there are only a few investigating companies looking to the brand value, and well, this refinement can be useful in an annual review, but not on something which is happening in the middle of the year. Therefore, it is more easy to use just the share price impact, and we'll show you in the cases made by Profundo what the impact can be. Other problem is that reputation risk can overlap with other risks, as reputation risk can lead, for instance, to loss of revenue. So that's leading to, let's say, some kind of a market access risk. So then we go back to the risk and there is some overlap there. That's a risk that we have already calculated. Also increased operating capital and regulatory costs. They are part of they need to be made to reduce the reputation, but in fact they are more operating costs. The literature, that's on the next slide. Well, this is immediately a very interesting one. By the way, it's not Peatland Research, it's Pentland Research. Pentland Analytics. This is a study of 2018, and it's a study called Reputation Risk in the Cyber Age. And in this study, there was an enormous amount of events. 125 ESG events were investigated in the last 10 years, 2008-2018 period. And what they arrived at for the whole group of the 2018 group is that there was a 5% loss in shareholders' value. You can see that in the table, in the column of average, you can see group 2018 minus 5%. However, if you divide that between the winners and the losers, and that was around 50-50 of that 125 cases, the winners gained 20%. And I come back later on why they were winners. And the losers, they lost 29%. So that's an enormous difference. There was also a group, a sample group for 2000. So that is already nearly 20 years ago. And at that time, let's say, nearly the same kind of research was done. And there was an average decline of only 4% of the value of the companies. And the winners gained only 10%. So that's only half of what we saw in the 2018 period, in the 2018 sample. And the losers, they lost only 17%. So that's also around half of what was lost in the 2018 sample group. So that is quite a big difference. If you look to the difference between the losers in reputation and the winners in reputation. And if you focus on 2018, you can see that if that the losers, if they would go from an index from 100 to minus and then minus 29, you go to 71, and the winners go to an index from 100 to 120, you can see that the winners gained 69% more value versus the losers. And in the 2000 example, this was only 33%. So there's a substantial increase in the impact of reputation. And this might be caused by the increasing impact of social media. We also talked about the increasing global markets, and also the increasing focus of investors on ESG themes. And if you add and other elements, and that should be at now at the right hand of the table, maybe you can go. Yes, that's the one. There it is. The elements that might have separated the winners from the losers, that's also an important element, that some winners, when they had a reputation event, that they had a much better crisis communication, which was much more instant and much more global in order to spur a recovery in value. And also an active social responsibility policy might have been a critical element in a value creating response. So these outcomes are quite interesting. The last line, please stay at the first page of the literature. Can you one sheet? Yeah, the last line is interesting. Is the impact on the beta, that is the part which is which is used in the calculation of the weighted cost of capital. And also there was a big difference in the 2018 sample group, was that the winners had a much lower impact on the cost of capital calculation than the losers. And this plus 12% stands for a negative impact of 4% on the enterprise value of a company. That compares to minus 2% only for which happened to the impact on the enterprise, negative impact of the winner. So that's a very, very interesting. This was very wide scale investigation by Pentland Analytics and Aon. And it's an important basis to look to other literature. And that's on the next slide. On the next slide, Professione in 2015 looked also to a wide range of data, to 62 reputation events in the 15 years before 2015. And here they made created a quantitative study, and they came to a value at risk of 28% of the enterprise value. Yeah, that's of course close to the 29% that was calculated in the Pentland Aon study, which we saw before. Palmrose did something. They looked to the reputation loss due to unexpected restatements of company profits. Here was a negative share price reaction of 9% in a two-day window. Karpov looked at old data that was from 1980 until 2000. Well, that's of course a long time ago, when the social media were much less visible, when global markets were much less there, and there the average stock price return was only minus 1.7%. So that's much lower than what we saw at 29 and 28% before. On the next slide, further literature is there. Quantitative literature, statistical literature is there. Carmeli and Tiesler, they found out that that reputation, all these literature, what you see on this sheet, is in fact that reputation is impacting profit. A better reputation is good for the profitability. And Carmeli and Tiesler found out that for 86 companies, Israeli industrial companies, and the relationship with companies' financial performance, they saw that a better reputation is leading to a higher growth of the company, and also that a better reputation is leading to a higher consumer order intake. Higher growth leads to more market share. Yeah, it seems to be quite logical, but this is statistical relevant. And also higher growth is leading to higher profitability and improved financial strength. If you look to Robertson and Dowling, companies with better reputation, they lead to a sustaining superior financial performance. And finally, that was from Deep House, which showed that a high relationship with media favorableness and the banks on returns on assets, there's a big statistical relation that reputation, an improved reputation, can improve the beta on ROA substantially. So that's quite a big impact. So literature is clearly there that there is a quantitative relation between reputation events and the value of companies. If we turn now to the case studies on reputation risk, this is how we did it for four of the case studies that we did. This is a very good example. JBS had many events. If we turn to the text below the table, you can see the different reputation events and events that happened to this company. First, the company was accused for fraud over loans by the Brazilian Development Bank. And you can see in the chart, in the figure, that there was in the first day minus 4%, let's say that were -2% and -9%. Were in the three trading days after this event that occurred. So, and for the next few days, it was also negative. So that was a substantial negative reputation event, while there were not yet any fines or anything, that there was less turnover or less sales by the company. So this was really a reputation event. A Moody's downgrade on May 22. You can see the box 22 May 2017 that led to a substantial decline in the -30%. So that was really substantial. However, in the days after, it recovered quickly, as you can see, by 8%, 1%, 23%. Later on, it was minus 8. Oh, no, sorry, that's for the next event of 26th of May, when the JBS chairman of the board resigned. It was a follow-up, of course, of reputation events in this company. The 31st of May, that was in fact where JBS agreed to pay a big fine. And that's where initially the stock price reacted positively, but later on it was again negative. And on the 6th of June, they decided to divest, which was seen as positive, as a positive balance sheet strengthening, but later on, if you add it up, it ended up negatively. Overall, all these events have hurt the reputation of this company, and has led to reputation value loss. The next one, that's a Facebook example, and the next three trading days after the event, that was after the Cambridge Analytica scandal. When that became public, Facebook stock fell by 8%, and that was a cumulative abnormal returns, where -8% or so versus a white versus a peer group. But it continued until the 26th of March. There was continuous negative abnormal returns for this company. For 2 months after the event, they have already gained back something, and they ended up with relatively small abnormal returns. And it was probably also because the company said to improve their business. Another next event is British Petroleum, 2010. It's already nearly 10 years ago, the Deepwater Horizon explosion in the Caribbean. And in fact, the negative impact on the stock, the abnormal returns were only -1% in the three trading days after April 20. However, for many months after that, there were many abnormal share price returns, and it grew over time. But of course, take into account, it ended up with a 29% relative stock price performance against the sector. And it ended up also with an average abnormal return, was -29%, but take into account, of course, that included in this is also that there was increasing evidence that there would be substantial material US dollar damage for this for BP, and that they had to pay for it. So here you can see that there is already an overlap of real visible payments that they will have to make and the reputation risk. So that's something I like to warn you for this. A current example, and we didn't make a case study of that, is, for instance, Bayer. For Bayer, there is currently around 5 billion, and the market expects that Bayer Monsanto, that it might be a 5 billion issue. But the reputation of the company has declined dramatically, and there is already 50 billion taken out of the market value, the equity value of this company. So that's substantial, 50 billion, and that's much more than the 26 billion of goodwill that was taken on the balance sheet because of the acquisition of Monsanto. If we turn to the KitKat thing of the KitKat campaign by Greenpeace, and on March 17, 2010, Greenpeace launched its famous campaign against Nestlé's KitKat brand by showing that video with the orangutan finger was inside the KitKat package. Well, first, there was nearly no impact, in fact. And however, later on, the event in 2010, on April 15, when Greenpeace disrupted the annual general meeting of shareholders meeting of Nestlé in Lausanne, then the stock price finally started to was negatively affected by 4% in the next 2 days. So that was really a reputation thing. However, Nestlé, in fact, reacted quite quickly, and by improving its supply chain, or by announcing to improve its supply chain to move to sustainable palm oil. And this announcement led to a 3% positive impact in the next three trading days. So that's that shows how things can turn positive if you have the right reaction. But this was 2010. Take that into account. And that was when social media was not as large as it was now, and also when the ESG penetration in the investment area was not as much as it is now. So if we turn to the next slide, we have written down here some elements why we think that the reputation value loss might increase to higher levels than we have seen in this KitKat thing. If we look to the Eco Pulse study of 2017, and where consumers said that they would stop buying a product based on environmental reputation of a company, that has increased sharply in 12-month survey period from 11% to 33%. And if we focus more on deforestation, in a YouGov poll in the 21st of May in the European Union, 25 European Union countries, and that's where Europeans said 87% of those polled across 25 European countries agreed that legislation is necessary to protect forests, and 91% also said that they cared deeply about forest and agreed that for deforestation is harmful. So deforestation is really becoming a bigger issue. Well, the NGOs, we already mentioned it, they have had many benchmark studies upcoming, and also that accelerated about the different approaches by fast-moving consumer good companies about how they execute the zero deforestation commitments. And a CDP study here about 9 food companies and 7 household and personal care companies. This was much more focused, by the way, about on climate change, but deforestation is part of climate change, as we have seen. And this CDP study showed the big differences between within that group of 9 food companies and the group of 7 household and personal care companies. If we turn to the next slide, we can see that the fast-moving consumer good companies are still lagging on action on deforestation, although there is a 4 times more commitments on deforestation by 3.5 times more companies, as you can see, between 2012 and 2017. CDP in a global supply chain report showed that that 47% of the suppliers to the fast-moving consumer are reporting on forest-related risk assessment, but only 70% have set deforestation-related targets. And in a Forest 500 report, the countdown to 2020 showed that 43% of the fast-moving consumer good companies are still not publicly reporting on actions where there's the risk of deforestation in the supply chains. So that's moving us to the conclusions already. On this slide, maybe you can press one time again to show the, yes, here. Society, consumers, NGOs, the awareness is growing on the deforestation impact. The differences of fast-moving consumer good companies' commitments on deforestation also becomes increasingly visible. And the finances policies on deforestation are also increasing. Take into account that currently 10% of global wealth is invested in some kind of ESG approach, 32 trillion of the 324 trillion of global investments. So that means that there is increasing awareness and that this everything coming together here, that there might be potential material investment risks for the losers if companies don't have a good policy and good actions. And there might be opportunities for the ones who are doing that right. And if we use the Pentland analytics outcomes, but also, and which is supported by our case studies and by other studies, then the winners, which have a 20% value gain, might outperform the losers, which might have a 20% value loss, by 70%. And that's quite a big amount. And this might be really an eye-opener for investors. So if we turn to the conclusions on the next slide. Yes, thank you. That not meeting the 2020 deadline of zero deforestation, that could really lead to material financial risk for investors in fast-moving consumer goods. Reputation events can impact companies' value by 30% negative. The CRS case studies confirm the scientific research on the value of impact of reputation risk. And probably very important is number 5, that there might be a value gap of 70% of up to 70% between companies which are doing good and between the companies which are handling deforestation in a bad way. With this big 70%, I like to open up to hand back the presentation to Matt.
Yes, thank you very much for that presentation. That was great. Now we have we're on to the Q&A part of the session. So first question: 2020 is approaching quickly. In which time frame do you think that these valuation impacts might occur?
Yeah. Well, in fact, that will not happen at the 1st of January 2020. That's for sure. Probably already, and that might need further research. Probably some part of this already has occurred. So there are already investors who are anticipating further negative effects. So they have already been very critical. They have already engaged on this subject, and there has already flowed money out of certain stocks which are still related to deforestation. And their valuation multiples have already moved behind the peer group. So something has already happened, and probably after 2020, it might also take a couple of years before further value losses and also value opportunities might occur.
Okay, great. Thanks for that. So in your reference to the EcoPulse study on consumers increasingly stopping to buy products exposed to deforestation, which geographies do the studies cover? And would you say that this is a global trend, including areas in emerging markets in Asia?
Yeah. This EcoPulse study, this is... I'm not completely sure, but I think this research is based in Western markets. So this is not probably not a right reflection of the global population. That is true. Many people, by the way, are negative about that China is not moving here, but China is a big market, of course. But there has been already ample proof that Chinese companies and also Chinese consumers are moving on this kind of subjects. So it's and also when I've done some research when I was still working at ING, we also saw that the awareness of climate change issues was already relatively large in several emerging markets. So this is, although this EcoPulse study is probably focused mainly on Western countries, also in emerging markets, there is increasing awareness. And sometimes they are much more even confronted with the negative impacts of climate change or pollution than in Western markets.
Okay, great. Thanks. And just a follow-up to that regarding the financiers and their policy, which banks were you referring to? Do you see that all global banks are progressing on their policies connected to deforestation?
Yeah, this question is related to the sheet on the weighted average cost of capital, and there are several companies, and one of the leaders here is ING. They have already issued several loans based on sustainability targets, which are based on Sustainalytics, for instance. Annual targets of reduction in certain, let's say, CO2 emissions per unit of sales. And ING has here been leading. They have already issued this kind of loans to DSM, to Philips, and to Wilmar. So, but also other banks are currently joining this. It is increasing, but it is clear that, for instance, in the palm oil chain, that still many which is mainly financed to Southeast Asian banks, that this still needs to develop. But that's also why chain reaction research is also engaging with central banks who are painting increasingly the risk of deforestation to their to the banks that they are supervising. And we are talking to the Bank of England, for instance. We are talking to the Brazilian Central Bank, but also Western central banks. They are also in all kinds of platforms discussing this kind of issues with central banks in developing markets.
Okay, great. Thank you for that. Next question. There doesn't seem to be long-term impact on reputation in the examples that you gave. So how do we ensure that FMCGs take long-term approach to changing their ways of operating?
Yeah. It's true that in especially in the cases before 2010, when social media were not so visible and impactful, that there were not very big impacts. And if you look to the Nestle and the KitKat example, that is an example why you could become relatively negative on the size of the value of reputation risk. However, what we want to we are painting a picture for, we are making analysis for the years ahead and how things are changing. That's why the Pentland study is so interesting, which compares the 2000 sample with that in 2018. And that's where you can see that the global markets become dominant, the more social media become dominant, and the more NGOs have become and have accelerated their studies on deforestation policies of sectors, of specific companies, of benchmarking fast-moving consumer goods versus other fast-moving consumer goods within the food sector or within the home and personal care sector. That this, if you assume that this intensity of research and of campaigning will continue, then the impact should become much bigger from 2018-19 onwards than versus the year 2000. And that's also where you see the trends happening in all the important layers. It's in the society, it's in the consumers, it's in the companies themselves, which have set for themselves deforestation. There's more activity from NGOs on this deforestation subject, and also at the investors, although the level of knowledge on deforestation is still low. We try to increase that knowledge, and investors are confronted with, every week they can go to conferences about this subject. Still, it's mainly focused on climate change, but also on deforestation. There is, and that's what we try to do by our roadshows from Chain Reaction Research to London. Tomorrow I will go to Brussels, and in October I will go to Frankfurt, and we will be on the Paris event of PRI. That's where we try to increase the knowledge also at the invest, that they will ask the questions to companies active in the deforestation supply chain. And with all the studies that we make, if there is something on casino group, we take a group, we take a look, okay, who is involved in this casino group financing, which shareholders are there, which bondholders are there, which of them have deforestation policies, and we inform them one-on-one on their current position in Casino Group or in Carrefour Group and their links to the deforestation in Brazil. And that's how it is spreading readily. And that's why the impact might be much larger. But yeah, further research will be required, and further outreach and the roadshows will be required to accelerate this knowledge.
Okay, great. We have time for about two more questions. One of them is regarding the cost of debt for companies that are exposed to deforestation. You mentioned a 50 basis points difference in cost of debt for companies that are exposed to deforestation. Which companies does this cost of debt apply to?
This is applied to an increasing number of sectors and an increasing number of companies. I think the first loan was in fact issued to by a syndicate, and that included ING. The first loan was issued to Wilmar, and that was of course that Wilmar has a big relation to palm oil. And I think the next ones were in DSM, that is a special chemical group, a special nutrition group nowadays, and Philips, that is of course an healthcare conglomerate. So that are quite different type of companies to which it have been applied. And I hope that this answers the question.
Great. Thanks for that. So the last question is regarding reputation risks in general. Are they only a concern for downstream companies, or are they also important? Are they also important for upstream producers and other operators along the agricultural commodity supply chains?
Reputation risk is, if you look to the numbers, it's most important for the downstream companies. However, also midstream traders, they have also reputation, but here it's much more the market access risk which is dominant, and for the producers it's much more the market access which makes up the largest part of the value at risk for those companies, and reputation is less important. So it's mainly the reputation is best applicable to the fast moving consumer good companies which are less hurt by market access and by stranded asset risk, which risk numbers are only hurting these companies for 1% or 2% or less than that.
And a follow up to that is, what kind of events are creating long term reputational damage for companies?
Sorry, again, a follow up.
What kind of events are creating long term reputational damage for companies?
This risk, like not handling deforestation in the right way, deforestation risk in the right way, not responding to this, or to climate change, the TCFD requirements, for instance, if you don't have anything in your annual report about the next steps, about the scenarios, how your company will be affected by climate change, what your strategy is to apply to this. This kind of events might impact the reputation substantially. However, this reputation let's say model is applicable to every kind to all kinds of events. So it's not only about deforestation, not only about climate change, it's also about plastic waste. Let's think about that. Plastic waste, which is an enormous problem, and which also for fast moving consumer good companies might become a part of reputation. How quickly is Unilever able to change its packaging from plastic to recycle packaging? So that is it's applicable to many reputation events.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot for that. And I'm sorry to everybody whose question we didn't get to. We'll be happy to follow up offline. You can get in touch with me or Gerard. Thanks again for your time. And we'll likely be having another webinar sometime relatively soon. Thanks again.